Welcome back for more physiology. We're going to be starting our unit on circulation, which is going to take us like a month and a half, 2 months to get through. So we're going to be here for a while. Bear with me. I think it's loads of fun. I hope you will too. What we're going to deal with today is how do we circulate blood around the body? In class, we talked about some three questions in order for me to figure out where you all are in terms of what you understand. And we'll use this to judge off of some other things. And we're going to keep doing this because this is mildly important because you all have some ideas as to what circulation is. So we all want to stay alive. And the way that we stay alive is we have this phenomenon that we call homeostasis or dynamic equilibrium. And the catch is not every value gets to stay the same. So if we look at our osmolarity, so our water balance, we keep that one pretty tight, but if we look at our pH, it can fluctuate a little bit more than our osmolarity can. Our temperature can fluctuate even more than that. The question then becomes, well, how in part can we control that, especially when we're talking about stuff inside of our bodies? That's when circulation comes in. What we need to have at all times is a constant level of nutrients, which are those six things in the picture, but you also turn out to need a removal system of all the wastes. Because if I can constantly be adding the nutrients that I will need, but removing the wastes I can't have around, the result is I can stay alive. And that turns out to be the job of the circulation. Let's move what we need in, take away what we need to remove. It seems to make sense. When we look at circulation, it turns out we have some parts that are necessary. In fact, we need three parts. You're going to need pipes in order to have everything flow around. We need to put something inside of those pipes, and then we need something to make it all move. We call that a pump. We give names to those pipes. We call them arteries and veins and capillaries and venules and arterioles and lymph vessels. The fluid that we stick inside, we call blood. And the pump, we for the most part, call the heart. There are a few other pumps inside of the body, however. When I look at circulation, I can divide all of the circulation into two aspects. We have one part, which is kind of horizontal in this figure, that go from the heart to your lungs. We call that the pulmonary circuit. And then we have another set that goes to the body, which is up and down in this figure, or what we would call the systemic circuit. What we end up doing is we have a divide and conquer approach, where one part of circulation will specialize in one thing and the other aspect will specialize in something else. It's a division of labor that for the most part works rather well. The way that we shove that blood around our body is with pressure. We go from a high pressure source to a low pressure source. So what's the pathway that it takes? Turns out it's predictable. If we start at the heart, blood leaving the heart will enter a tube called an artery. That artery is then going to move towards the lungs. From the lungs, it's going to enter in a different tube called a vein, which will come back to the heart, which will then leave again through an artery, which will then go to some part of the body, which could include the lungs again, back into a vein, to heart, to artery, lungs, vein, heart, artery, body, vein, heart, artery, lungs, vein. We keep this pattern going. This will always work. There are exceptions to patterns. This is not one of those exceptions. That pattern will always hold true. When we start adding a little bit more detail, we'll see where it's going to fail. To keep driving this down, we need to, as we move through all those parts, we need to have a pressure gradient. We need to have a difference in pressure. And what you notice when you look at this graph is it starts out with the pressure in the arteries being relatively flat, and at the bottom in the veins, it's relatively flat. Slightly angled downhill, but they're both pretty flat. The result in that is still we have a high pressure and a low pressure, and as long as we move from high to low pressure, blood will keep on flowing. As we deal with those high pressures, that seems to be pretty easy to keep it going. It's those veins at the bottom that we might turn out to have some trouble. The source of all the pressure is actually going to be a phenomenon that we call ventricular systole, which we'll talk about in great detail later. But ventricular systole is a very fancy way of saying the heartbeat, or in particular the ventricles, which are the bottom part of the heart, were beating. And that ends up driving all of the pressure that we turn out to need. As that blood moves on through, if you remember from the graph of blood pressure, which is this one, we have that little flat line down at the bottom. We have to worry about blood accidentally maybe rolling backwards in that case because the pressure is so low. So that could be like you standing on your head or lying down or holding your feet up. What we have to do is ensure that blood is moving from the heart and back to the heart through arteries, then veins, not going from veins to arteries. So what we have inside of our body are little checkpoints called valves. And what valves do is they make blood flow in one direction. It'll start from the heart into an artery, into lungs or body, into a vein, back to the heart. The fancy word for not letting blood move backwards is called retrograde flow or retrograde motion, but that's their job. When they fail on us, we get weird things going on, like we can get blood clots or we can get a heart murmur or we can have varicose veins. We don't want this to happen. So what happens at that lung and body part? Well, it turns out we have pressure and we have osmosis to play with. So osmosis is going to be coming back. We have a while till we get there, but osmosis will be coming back to us. And what we need to have is a way to make sure that we actually put what we need in and take away what we don't want. The way that we can describe all of that flow is through something referred to as Poisson's law. Poisson, that gentleman there in the photo, was a French engineer, and he talked about making fluids, so things like gas and liquid, flow through a pipe, because he was an engineer. We can apply all of his laws to us in physiology. But the catch is he had four variables. Well, technically there's another one in there, which is flow, which is a Q. Viscosity, which is that first one, is the resistance to flow. Here's what I mean by that. If you were to take water and syrup, pour water, flows easily. Take syrup, doesn't flow as easily. Syrup has high viscosity, water would have low viscosity. Length would be how long are you letting it dump through, makes sense. Cross-sectional radius, you all know circles, middle to the outside, that's a radius. Pressure would be how hard are you pushing. Those four variables can define how well blood flows through your body. And we're going to actually derive Poisson's law. If you look it up, there's actually a whole bunch of terms, and there's like a pi thrown in there, and there's like something to the fourth power. We don't need to understand any of that because that's not the point. Poisson's law is a set of relationships that tell you, oh, if this goes up, here's what's going to happen to blood flow. If this goes up, here's what's going to happen to blood flow. If this goes up, here's what happens to blood flow. And the result is, what is the heart going to do about it? Because the heart is going to be the source of pressure. So your pre-lab, which isn't too bad, involves answering 8 questions, which is procedure 1. You have to come in with those 8 things answered, and we're going to ask you about them in class.